Please stand as you are able for the reading of the scripture lessons. Today's scripture lesson is taken from Luke chapter 17, verses 5 through 10. The apostles said to the Lord, "Increase our faith." And the Lord said, "If you had faith like a mustard seed, you would say to this mulberry tree, 'Be uprooted and be planted in the sea,' and it would obey you. Which of you, having a slave plowing or tending sheep, will say to him when he has come from the field, 'Come immediately and sit down to eat'? But will he not say to him, 'Prepare something for me to eat, and properly clothe yourself, and serve me while I sit and eat and drink? And afterwards you may eat and drink.' He does not thank the slave because he did these things which were commanded, does he? So you too, when you do all the things which are commanded of you, say, 'We are unworthy slaves. We have done only that which we ought to have done.'" The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
You may be seated. Thank you, Greg. How would you finish this sentence in your own words? If I had more faith, I would. If I had more faith, I would. How would you finish that sentence? Today, I'd like for us to consider the implications of the first part of this text, where the disciples said to Jesus, "Lord, increase our faith." But before we get too far, let me set the scene for you for this context of this experience. Back in Luke 9:51, Jesus has been encountering some challenges in his public ministry of teaching and healing. And verse 51 in chapter 9 says, "And he resolutely set his face towards Jerusalem." To be resolute means to be clear, to be definitive, to be certain. We don't know why Jerusalem at this point in time in Jesus' ministry, but he was out on the border of Samaria and Galilee, a ways away from Jerusalem. They had to travel up across the Jordan River Valley, the Jordan River, where it comes into the Sea of Galilee, and go back around all the way down, and then go up into the city of Jerusalem. A trip that took some time. And so from verse 51 in chapter 9, all the way through till Jesus gets into Jerusalem, and in Luke's gospel, if you go in chronologically, that takes about 12 to 13 chapters. In every circumstance, the disciples are seeing and witnessing, sometimes indirectly, sometimes very directly, in the life of Jesus' ministry. In fact, in John 4, they travel through Samaria to get to Galilee. You may remember that story. And it's a dry, thirsty day, and they stop at a well in Sychar, Jacob's well. And remember, Jesus meets a woman there, and they have an encounter, and this woman comes to faith. Jesus offers her living water, and she drinks, and she goes home to her village, and she tells everybody, and they invite Jesus home for a discipleship weekend. It was wonderful. That was in John's gospel, but not here. Not in Luke. Jesus is rebuffed. He has turned away. They said, "No thanks, we're not interested in what you're talking about today." The questions of the disciples then come as the results of hearing and experiencing some of these rebuffing moments, and they're getting a little stressed as they're moving towards Jerusalem with Jesus. And so they say, "Increase our faith, Lord." And then Jesus responds and says, "A little bit of faith goes a long way." That in essence is what he says in those verses. The Greek word for faith is the word pistis, which is translated trust, confidence, or commitment. Jesus responds to their quest of increasing their faith with poetic language. He uses the imagery of a mustard seed. They all know it's a very, very small seed. And he says to them, Maybe he has one in his hand. Who knows? But he says, if you have faith, even as minuscule as the size of this mustard seed, you can say to that mulberry tree over there, be uprooted and be planted in the sea. It's an exaggeration. It's a huge hyperbole. Jesus is making a point here using language that they would understand. Mulberry trees don't grow in the sea. But Jesus is saying to the disciples, if you just have this much faith, you can make some remarkable things happen. These guys, I have to give it to them, they've been tested often, these 12. And they discovered that being around Jesus could be upsetting sometimes and make them question what they ever decided to do in the first place. Remember one time when they were going across the Sea of Galilee? And in the gospel stories, in Mark's gospel in particular, the disciples in Jesus are constantly going from the kosher side, the Israel side of the Sea of Galilee, across to that other side, that side where demons lived and where Gentiles lived and where bad things could happen to you. They were going back and forth. One night they were in a boat. And as we say down south, it came up a bad cloud. Any of you folks ever been on the water? I go fishing in the marsh every once in a while, South Louisiana. If you see a cloud coming, you better crank up the boat. And I'd be John Brown. David Lott in Greenwood, Mississippi would always say, let me throw it one more time. You don't do that. You get the heck out of Dodge. They were out on the boat in the river, in the lake, and it came up a bad cloud. Guess where Jesus was? Sleeping. In the back of the boat. They wake him up and say, Lord, don't you care that we are perishing? And he looks at them and he says, have you no faith? Have you no faith? They were headed to a situation that had potential to be more than a storm out on the Sea of Galilee. You see, there are some places and some circumstances where you need to use wise caution. Have any of you ever been to Baton Rouge on a Saturday night in the fall? Amen. Have you ever been the fan of the opposition playing the Fighting Tigers? Woe to you if you've been that person, and even more so, woe to you if your team wins. A few years back when this cat named Manning was playing in Oxford, my wife and I happened to be there. It was her first time in Tiger Stadium. And it was a cool night, and I'd given her my red and sweatshirt that had those words that some of you won't say out loud on them. It was in the fourth quarter. And Mr. Manning had thrown the winning touchdown. And I had on a hunting jacket that I'd had because we had gone fishing the day before. And I said, here, darling, put this on. And as we're walking down this big spiral thing, I said, don't make eye contact with anybody and don't smile. Multiply that times 100. And you might begin to understand why the disciples were being concerned about their future. They were going to Jerusalem, a city that stoned prophets, that killed people, that got out of line. So, we may deduce something, that proximity to Jesus, no matter how close, doesn't protect us. If we're following Jesus, we may find our own Jerusalem sometimes. There may be circumstances we weren't prepared for because we were following and being faithful. So how much faith does it take? What kind of faith does it take? A friend of mine preached this text a few years ago in his congregation. And the audience that day was an elderly gentleman who was raised in Denmark, and he was well into his 80s. He offered a different view on the relationship between mustard seed and increasing faith for the disciples. He told about what was going on in Germany in the 1940s besides the war. The Germans experimented with extracting the oil from the mustard seed. They would pick the plants, they would put them through a process that would pulverize and squeeze the juice out of the seed. That done, they would process the remains of the plant and use it and form it into cakes and dry it for cattle feed. They didn't, however, expect what happened when the cows ate the cakes. I didn't know this, but cows have three stomachs. The food was processed into all three stomachs, and then it came out where it was supposed to come out, and it hit the ground. What they didn't anticipate was that every time there was an excrement that came to come to the ground in a patty, as we would call it, eventually there grew a mustard plant. The old man came up to the pastor after he finished his story, and he said, "The size of the mustard seed should not be thought of in terms of mass, but of endurance." Is it possible today? Is it possible for you and I to have a trust that great faith is not about quantity, but rather about endurance? Perhaps it's not for us to have more faith today, but to rather engage the world and the journey of faith with what we have. Faith that is open to God's direction. Faith that is assured that if we keep following, we will get there. Because the there is to be with God. Now and in the future. To trust God. To listen to God. To follow even when the way is rough. That's faith that matters. Faith that keeps us following. We need faith for the journey following Jesus. No matter what encounters we may face. When I was in college, I was a part of a group of young adults who were planning some career in ministry. At that time, I wanted to be a youth pastor, to play the guitar and to sing and to do retreats and things like that. But one of the experiences we had in worship was to learn this song. And it was a song that we began to attribute to the journey of faith, of making our lives count by taking the faith that we had as young college kids, not very bright, and trusting God with it to see where it would take us. And we found this song and we liked it, and so we learned it, and we used to sing it together in worship. And I'd like to teach it to you. It's very simple. The melody is easy. And I'll sing it for you one time, and then I'll help you learn it. Think about this song this week. I hope you at least hum the tune. And I want you to think about those disciples following Jesus towards Jerusalem. I want you to think about what might be your Jerusalem, where you're headed with your life right now, and how you're using the faith you have to follow. Here it goes. We are going, heaven knows where we are going, we'll know we're there, we will get there, heaven knows how we will get there, we know we will. This is a little different, but it's fun. It may be hard, we know, and the road may be muddy and rough, but we'll get there. Heaven knows how we will get there. We know we will. Now this tune may seem like it ought to be sung in a tavern. It could be. But the words are what we're going to be after. So give it your best try. We are going, heaven knows where we are going. will know we're there. Repeat the melody. We will get there. Heaven knows how we will get there. We know we will. It may be hard, we know. It may be hard, we know. And the road may be muddy and rough, but we'll get there. Heaven knows how we will get there. We know we will. One more time, now you got the hang of it. Lift your voices, we are gold. We, heaven knows where we are going. We'll know we're there. We will get there. Heaven knows how we will get there. We know we will. But we'll get there. Heaven knows how we will get there. We know we will. Lord, give us faith to follow. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Would you join me as we share in the giving of ourselves to God and as God has disclosed and given himself to us through the sacrament of Holy Communion? I would say that this is not the Methodist table. This is the Lord's table. Anyone can come and be a part of this experience of receiving the bread. We will break the bread apart and offer it to you, and you'll take it and dip it in this cup. And then eat. The altar will be open after you've received communion if you'd like to pray there. The ushers will begin on this section over here at this aisle and on the far aisle over here. And those of you on this side and this side, if you'll come to the centers and go back to your seats that way, and then the center aisles, if you'll come to the center and go back to your seats that way, it'll all be in order and good. Now, Christ, our Lord, invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sins and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors. We have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.